this 2 Timothy why the scriptures were written. He says in 2 Timothy 3:15, the Holy Scriptures are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus.
Thank you. 34 of your Pew Bible. It's Psalm 119, verses 97 through 104. Oh, how I love thy law. It is my meditation all the day. Thy commandment makes me wiser than my enemies, for it is ever with me. I have more understanding than all my teachers, for thy testimonies are my meditation. I understand more than the aged, for I keep thy precepts. I hold back my feet from every evil way in order to keep thy word. I do not turn aside from thy ordinances, for thou hast taught me. How sweet are thy words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Through thy precepts I get understanding, therefore I hate every false way. Our second scripture reading this morning is on page 1039 of your Pew Bible. It's 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 14 through chapter 4, verse 5. But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have firmly believed, knowing from whom you learned it, and how from childhood you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to instruct you for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word, be urgent in season and out of season, convince, rebuke, and exhort, be unfailing in patience and in teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own likings, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander into myths. As for you, always be steady, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We will now sing the first verse of Jesus Loves Me as our youth come forward for their special message today.
Family, but spoken down from God through someone else. So every word in this big book is from God. So we need to listen to every word that is written in the Bible, not just pick and choose what we want to have the story be. Let's say a prayer, okay?
When he talks about the scriptures, when he is informing Timothy that, you know, what do you have to rely on when the going gets tough, he says, Paul says to Timothy, it's the scriptures. And he's saying to Timothy that, you know, as Christians, we need to have sort of a scriptural toughness about us. Because these scriptures that we say, we try to base our lives upon, these scriptures, they are the basis of who we are as God's people. And he's trying to relay this to Timothy. He's trying to tell him, you know, you've got the scriptures to rely on. And that's what's going to keep you through. That's what's going to help you persevere through all types of situations, through all types of circumstance in life. So what I call this is scriptural toughness. I think as Christians, that's something that we all need to develop. Shall we pray? Gracious God, may the words of my lips and the meditations of our hearts and minds be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. These verses from 2 Timothy, and remember, I think I told you last week, if you were here or not here, either one, you probably don't remember anyway. The second letter of Paul to Timothy is, as far as biblical scholars know, is the very last letter that Paul ever wrote in this fashion to a church or to a disciple. The second letter of Timothy, as far as we can understand historically, this is the last letter that Paul ever wrote and sent out. Because it was shortly after this, as far as we can determine, that Paul was killed in a Roman jail, or else he died in a Roman jail. We're not really certain exactly what happened to Paul. We know that he didn't come out of that jail alive. And you've got to realize, conditions in Roman jails were not anything like the jail we have here now. If a prisoner got sick or ill or whatever, so what, they didn't care. You know, a lot of prisoners died in ancient jails just because they were not considered to be much of anything. Anyway, if they got sick, you're not going to send a doctor in to take care for them or whatever. So it may have been that Paul, who was getting up in age at this time in his life anyway, he may have gotten sick and just simply died in jail. He may have died of old age, or he may have actually been killed. We're not exactly certain, but we do know this was the end of his life. And as far as we can ascertain, historically, the second letter to Timothy was the very last letter that he ever wrote. And we believe, if you read that letter very closely, Paul seems to know that he's at the end of his life. I mean, a lot of the comments that he's making here, he's referring to the fact that, Timothy, you need to carry on. It's like he's handing the baton over to Timothy. He knows that he's at the end of his ministry. He's at the end of his life. And there are several phrases and different passages in 2 Timothy where Paul is really indicating, you know, this is the end for him. He doesn't believe he's ever going to start any more churches. He's ever going to be able to get out and minister to anyone else, preach to anyone else. This is sort of the last word that he's giving to Timothy. And this is near the end of this letter. And he's telling Timothy, you've got to continue to persevere in your faith throughout all of your life. And he says one of the ways that you do that is you look to Scripture. You've got to know Scripture. As And so these verses that that Ann read for us this morning, they sort of tell us what to do. And we'll get to that in a minute, but I want to go back a little bit to understand this, you know, why we think we need mental toughness. Paul has already talked to Timothy in this letter about the challenges to our faith. We all have challenges to our faith, and some days it's just a lot harder to believe than it is on other days. We've all been there, and we will continue to be there throughout our lives. And Paul has addressed this quite often in this passage. And he's also saying in that we have to be careful and watch what the world says to us and not let the world get inside our head. And all the things the world is saying that are not necessarily Christian or not necessarily godly, we have to be very careful with that. Timothy says one of the worst things that can happen to us is to let the world get inside our head and let those little voices inside our head be the world's voices instead of God's voice in our head. And Timothy says, or Paul tells Timothy, that one of the best solutions for that not happening is to stand on Scripture, to know the Scriptures, to read the Scriptures, to make them a part of your life. God's Word, if it gets inside your head, then you hear it. And that then is what you have that's resonating with you instead of all these little things the world might say to us, like, we can't do this, or we're not supposed to do that, or whatever. That's why Paul can tell Timothy to stay the course and not grow discouraged by all the craziness in the world. And he says, and Ann read to us, but as for you, continue in what you have learned and what you have been convinced of. You know, there's a big difference between being childish in your faith and being grounded with a childlike trust in God. Being childish a lot of times makes us susceptible to doubts, susceptible to the things the world says to us. For example, and I'm not saying any of us fall into this category, but there's a lot of thinking among Christians today, and we certainly hear this a lot, that does God really expect the average believer to know the Bible and to share their faith with other people? Now, wait a minute. That's what Pastor Steve's for, right? That's why we have him. We leave that kind of stuff to the experts, right? You know? Right? Is that right, Gene? No, it's not right at the moment. But that's what we hear. You know, it's very, you know, that why do you have a pastor that stands up here in front of you ever? You know, that's what I do. You know, I'm supposed to share this word and tell you all about the Scripture. But the Scripture actually expects us all as Christians to be able to share our faith with other people. If our entire faith is based upon what we learned in Sunday school when we were kids, if our entire faith is based upon what our parents taught us or told us when we were little kids, which for a lot of us that is the truth, then we're not really that mentally or scripturally tough. We're not really that aware of what it is that the Scriptures are actually saying. And that's not to mean that parents shouldn't make teaching their children the top priority. Parents do need to try to teach their children the Christian faith. It's just that we want Christians, as they mature, to actually mature in their faith, to grow all of your life, whether you're less than 2 years old or whether you're almost 91 years old. They're still supposed to be maturing and growing in your faith your entire life. And not just to base your faith on things you learned a long ago. We have to continue to dive into the Scripture and to listen to God's Word and to hear it in a new way each and every day. But Paul says there's a lot of dangers in the world that sort of tries to get us away from that. And Paul says we need to be aware of the dangers that are out there. He said, for the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they'll gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. And we've seen that happen over and over and over again in history. That people will listen to what the world has to say, and their paths will be led in the wrong direction. Now that wouldn't happen to us today, but let me give you a couple of examples where I actually see that and think that it does happen to a lot of us in the world today when we're trying to think about our faith and who we are as Christians, and we want to be able to defend our faith, we want to be able to express the way, the truth, and the life. Well, one of the things that you hear from a lot of circles in the world today, that there is no absolute truth. You know, there's just a lot of different types of variables, and there's lots of different types of scenarios, and you can go on down lots of different types of paths, and there's no one absolute truth. And when you hear that, and you're trying to say, well, God gives us a truth, a way, a life, and people say, well, that's not really an absolute truth. You know, it's very discouraging to try to argue against that. But there are so many people that look at life this way. There is no absolute truth in life. That, you know, there is no one truth, one way in life. And it's real, it's almost impossible to give a response to that. If there is no absolute truth, then how can the Bible be the truth? I think there's a lot of that kind of thinking that goes on in our world this day. Let me give you one other example. A lot of times you hear someone dismiss anything that comes out of the Bible because this thing was written by human beings. Now, they might have been inspired by God, but it was humans that wrote these words on these pages. And you know what? Human beings are not perfect. Human beings make mistakes. And so even if they were inspired by God, human beings wrote this thing. There's got to be some mistakes in there. There's got to be some things that are wrong in there. And you know, we think about that and you go, you know, I'm a human being, I make mistakes. Yeah, that's, you know, and it even says in the Bible that human beings, you know, were not perfect creations. But how do you offer a response to that? You know, that sort of thinking gets inside your head. You go, maybe there are some things that aren't quite true. And so you do like Joan. You might not actually rip the page. I'd say, I don't like that one. That was probably one that's wrong. You know, that one's got to be wrong. Let's leave that one out. Let's don't read it or just rip it out if we think we need to do that. And you know, those are a couple of critiques of Christianity today, that there is no absolute truth. And that the Bible was written by human beings. And so it's got to be, got to have mistakes in it. So I just wanted to tell you this morning, from my own perspective, both of those ideas are sort of self-defeating. Number one, if there is no absolute truth, then that statement's probably wrong, isn't it? Or wait a minute, even if it's right, that's circular reasoning to say there is no absolute truth, because that's an absolute statement. You know, how can you believe in that? Is there truth or is there not? If there is nothing absolute in this world, well, then my statement must be wrong. It's sort of a self-deceiving, circular type reasoning when you get into that. You know, I stand on something. I believe there is a God. And I believe God is an absolute truth. If you believe there's no absolute truth, then I'm probably right, because if you said there's no absolute truth, that's got to be wrong, because there's no absolute truth. So so that's sort of self-defeating itself. If there's no truth, then that applies to what you just said, then no one should believe you if there's no absolute truth, because you've got to be wrong. But anyway. What about that other myth that the Bible's full of mistakes because it's written by people? Yeah, it was written by people. Let's think for a minute about the things that you, in your lifetime, the things that you say, the things that you've done, and the things that you've written in your lifetime. Is everything you've said and done and written in your lifetime a mistake? Everything you did wrong? You probably made some mistakes, right? But the vast majority of what we say and what we do in our lives are not mistakes. But we're human beings. Well, we made a few mistakes, but sometimes, probably more often than not, we speak the truth. And we do our best to speak the truth. And certainly, if we are trying our best to follow God's guidance, the vast majority of the time, we are speaking the truth. If you think about that a little bit, and you think that this Bible really is God-inspired, and the men, the people that wrote this work, and I'm sorry, ladies, but it was almost all men. The men who wrote this work really were inspired by God and doing their best to follow what God would have them do and say and write in their lives. There's no reason to toss this Bible out just because you say people wrote it down. And I made a few mistakes in it, but the vast majority of what's here, of course, to me, is going to be truth, and it's going to be absolute truth. And who is it to me to decide, well, this line is right and that line is wrong? I'm not so presumptuous that I have such an intellect that I can make that decision. This is God-inspired work. And with that, we take it and apply it to our lives in the best way that we can. And we hope that God will guide us as we try to apply God's scriptures to our lives. So those two lines of reading that I'm trying to give you, they're not even faith reasons for rejecting the worldly assumptions that there is no absolute truth and this stuff was written by human beings. Those are just use your brain type of reasoning, if you will, to find holes in the attempt to get us to doubt God's truth. It's truly our faith that will sustain us, our knowledge that there is a God, a loving God, and that we are children of God. We don't want to let the world get inside of our heads and tell us some things differently. We want to be aware of the dangers of the world, but we don't want to allow the world to create doubts in our mind about who we are as a child of God. And Paul says, but you keep your head in all situations, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, discharge all the duties of your ministry. He's talking to Timothy, but he's talking to all of us today as well. Discharge all the duties of your ministry. You, and only you, know what God's call is on your life. That's between you and God. So you have a different way of looking at the world than anybody else when it comes to God's truth and when it comes to God's scripture. So Paul is saying, follow your call from God and do the ministry that you're called to do. It may not be standing up here on a Sunday morning and preaching to people. But you are called to a ministry to help establish God's kingdom on this earth. You are a part of God's family, and you have a role. So it is God's word that keeps us grounded when the world tries to get inside our heads. Consider for just a moment the main purpose for which this Bible was written. This Bible was not written as a history book. This Bible was not written to be a science trope. The Bible was not written to do so many of the things. It was not written to entertain us. It was not written to do so many of the things that most books are written to do. Paul reminds us in this 2 Timothy why the scriptures were written. He says in 2 Timothy 3:15, the holy scriptures are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. The number one problem with the way most people see the Bible is that they don't understand that the Bible is all about pointing you knowledge of Jesus. That's why we have this Bible. So it can point us to Jesus Christ, the salvation that God provides for us through Jesus Christ. Scripture contains the power of salvation. So whenever you face issues in life, whatever issues burden you, you know that Jesus is still there for you. Jesus is actually your spiritual toughness, if you will. Because it's right there in the pages of Scripture. God's plan of salvation for you and for me. The Bible is so different than any other book. It's so unique compared to any other, even sacred writing that you might pick up that's called sacred in other religions. Remember what Paul said here in this passage. All Scripture is inspired by God. Useful for teaching, for rebuking, for correcting, and for training in God's righteousness. No other writing comes from the mouth of God through the instrument of human writers to give us God's own facts and God's own truth about who we are and why we are here in this world. It's not just your parents and your grandparents that stands behind Scripture. You might have taught you some Scripture. It's God that stands behind this Scripture because they truly were inspired by God. God wants you to drop dead, to dive back into Scripture and go deeper than you ever have in your life before into Scripture. He wants us to come back to church for encouragement with a community of other fellow Christians, of other people of faith. But he wants us to go back to the Bible over and over again to study it, to deepen our understanding and appreciation of what God has done for us in our lives and what God can continue to do for us if we'll put our trust and our faith in Him. God gives you the gift of Scripture to combat your feelings with the objective truth of Scripture that declares that you are holy. You are holy because of Jesus. You are an heir to God's salvation through your faith in Jesus Christ. That's what the Scripture is trying to tell us. And what Scripture can do for you, for any of us, it can do for other people as well. God's Word makes you, each one of you, not just me, because I've been somehow trained, but it makes each one of us as Christians completely outfitted and able to meet the demands of your life of faith, of our lives of faith. That's what Scripture's for. That's why we need to know it. That's why we need to study it. That's why we need to dive into it. And God does outfit us for the challenge of life. He says, as Paul says here in 2 Timothy, preach the word. Be prepared in season and out of season. Correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience. A lot of times we don't hear that part. With great patience and careful instruction. Paul tells Timothy, and he tells us to stand ready with God's word at all times in your faith journey. He says to do it in a brave and steady way. And if we will stand steady with God's word, that will ensure our own faithfulness, our faithfulness to God, and our faithfulness to the main message of the Bible, God's plan of salvation for you and for me. So my friends, whether you watch football or baseball or whatever sport, to be entertained or simply for the love of the sport, or because you have a child or a grandchild playing so you have to go, or because it gives you an underdog to cheer for. I don't know about a cheer for in the World Series. They're both, you know, whatever. But whatever, if you watch sports and you like sports, whatever, you watch them, it's not going to make a big change in your life what happens in that sporting event. Whether your team wins or loses. You know, you can admire tough competitors on the football field. You can go out there and watch Jacob try to tackle that quarterback and see where he did it. And if he does it, you know, we can admire and applaud and be proud of that. But it's in the pages of Scripture. It's through Scripture that God gives us God's toughness to face life. God's Word show us a plan, God's plan of our salvation. God's Word is powerful, and it is reliable. And I believe that you can confidently use God's Word to equip yourself to face anything in this life that might come up against. This book is not just a feel-good story about an underdog. This book is God's powerful, reliable Word. And this book saves lives. It saves people's lives, like yours and mine. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us respond to this Word this morning by rising together, either in body or in spirit, and singing our hymn of response, which is number 406. Wonderful words of love. Shall we rise together and say,
the life of the world to come. Amen.
generous in your gifts.
Thank you.
Gracious God, we ask that you use the tokens presented here this morning to help spread your old-time religion throughout this world, so that your word may be known, that your message may be heard, and so that all can be touched by your love and power. Gracious God, we know, we now recognize that fall is among us. The seasons are changing once again from the green brilliance of trees full of life to the reds and browns and yellow leaves that signify it's time to prepare for the next season, the next phase of life. As time draws onward, it reminds us of who we are and hopefully of what our calling is on this planet. Holy God, you give meaning to every moment. And we ask that you allow us to do the same. May we be faithful in your sight in how we prepare each day to encounter a life committed to your gospel message, a life that sacrifices, a life that seeks growth, a life that wants to be like Jesus Christ in word and in deed. Hear what we bring you this day, O God, and with our commitment, help shape us in that image. Our God, you created each of us differently with different thoughts, different opinions, different experiences, different lives. We don't always see things the same way. And while some consider this a drawback as we come to worship and as your children, we should consider this a blessing. So help us with the guidance of your scripture to encounter conflict well, with open hearts and open minds. Ready to resolve that conflict for our sake, for the other's sake, and especially for your sake, our God, in connection and in love with your children and with you. We ask now that your spirit of comfort and love be with all those that we have mentioned by name in this service, and with all those that go unmentioned but that we still carry in our hearts and in our minds. Those who may be in pain, those suffering from loss or from illness, just those who are in need, may your peace be with them at this time. We pray all these things in the name of the Lord of love, care, and unity, Jesus the Christ, who taught us to pray as one people, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us now rise one last time in body or in spirit and open our hymnals to page 389. Which is Spirit of the Living God, as we rise now together and sing. as we go from this place today, I hope you can come and join us for the harvest party and the hay ride that we're having this afternoon. It should be a great day for that. But as you go your way throughout this day and throughout this week, always remember that God is right there with you. God is with us in the Scripture. So often we forget that we need to spend time here as often as we can, because that's our instruction, that's our guide. But regardless of what we're doing, whether we're reading the Scriptures or eating a meal or out on a hayride on a beautiful fall evening, we need to remember that God is always there with us, because God is always above us. God is always below us. God always goes behind us. God always walks before us. God always stands right beside